excited to have Dr. Morganne Reid joining me today on the Find Your Purpose Now podcast. So, Dr. Reid, let's just get right to it. Why is it important for people to know their purpose and find it and make the decision to live their purpose?
Yeah, so I think a lot of the work that I do is around suicide prevention. And I think people hear suicide prevention and they think it is really dark and heavy. And there is a part of that that is very true. And it is really heartbreaking. And at the same time, the other side of suicide prevention is so deeply entrenched in hope. And it's all about living, actually, and finding the thing that is worth living for and starting very small. Like, what is going to just help you get to tomorrow? And then when you start to string those little tomorrows together, you start to figure out, oh, this is why I'm here, or this is why I'm living, as opposed to, I don't know, getting bogged down in like different daily ups and downs.
So do you think that people who reach that point of, I just can't do this anymore, and they literally are considering taking their lives, it sounds to me, but I'm really, you know, I think of everything in terms of purpose. So maybe I'm making a connection that you didn't intend to make, but I'm thinking, gosh, that sounds like that if you don't know your purpose, or you don't even think you have a purpose, that it would be much easier to get overwhelmed with the details of life and to just decide it's just too much and to check out. Am I making a connection that you were intending to make?
Yeah. I mean, the biggest antidote, right, or treatment for someone who is suicidal is creating a meaningful life. That feels like a big task. But what I actually love about this work is you actually get working with people who are, unfortunately, at some of the hardest points in their lives. They actually have so much more clarity because they see things in sometimes a really dark way, but also in a very clear way. And it may be that they have not figured out that their purpose doesn't need to be to cure cancer, or, you know, to go off and, you know, speak to hundreds of thousands of people. Your purpose may be, you know, taking in a foster dog a week, you know, something like that, that it doesn't feel like it is this monumental thing, but what getting up and feeding that dog in the morning is your purpose right now. That is what you're here for. And that matters so much, and it's worth being alive for.
Oh, I love that. I think that social media, you know, TV, movies, you know, all of it have sort of led us to believe that if we're not some amazing celebrity superstar influencer, and we're having some amazing glamorous life, and the news vans are not following us every moment of the day, you know, or the paparazzi chasing us down, that we're, you know, that our purpose doesn't matter, that's what matters, you know, living that kind of life. And that's just nonsense. That's complete fantasy from, I don't know, you know, from Hollywood. So I love that you shared that our purpose can, whatever our purpose is, whatever it is, we shouldn't judge it.
Mm-hmm.
I think people do that. They say, oh, well, you know, it doesn't matter. It's so mundane or whatever. No, it matters.
Yeah.
And that's what you brought up about fostering dogs, because I know that right next to you is a little foster guy who lost a leg, and he's just adorable, and you love him, and he doesn't even know he lost a leg.
And I mean, I think this is, it's, there isn't like a separation between me and a suicidal person. Like, I guess what I don't want, the whole thing is, your life is just as worth living if you're sitting in a hospital or, you know, hurting yourself as someone else's, as mine is, as your therapist. Like, there isn't, we can all apply these principles Like, I have days when I feel hopeless. And then I'm like, you know what? Yeah, I need to get up and feed this dog.
Yes.
And so it's the same question. And just because you're sort of at this place, I think people who are in a suicidal crisis, they do often have more, at times, more clarity. But that doesn't mean that, you know, figuring out what's going to wake you up in the morning isn't as applicable to me as it is to you.
So it's a universal human thing. We all need to have a reason to wake up in the morning.
Yeah. And it just can be a small thing to start.
So talk about, if you would, that clarity that people who are really, literally, seriously considering taking their life, how do they have that clarity? Is they've dialed down the noise on the rest of the world? How does this happen?
I just think a lot of us do things for, like what you were saying earlier, for the social feedback, or because we think we're supposed to do it, or we're supposed to be following this prescribed path, whatever it is. But there's a lot of shoulds and supposed tos. Mm-hmm. And so when someone gets to the point of wanting to not live anymore, quote unquote, we should want to live, right? And when we're fully at the point where we're giving up on that, it's like, well, all society's sort of shoulds have gone out the window at that point. So you're at a net zero. So let's pick one thing to bring into tomorrow or tomorrow morning or tonight that's going to get you through the next hour. And when you take it and really distill it down to that, it feels less overwhelming. And I think I've seen people have so much insight in those moments where it's like, the world is overwhelming and society is a lot and there are so many responsibilities, but like, let's just cut that out for a second. And why do you want to be here tomorrow? Some of the answers I think are amazing, because that tells you what really matters to that person.
Ooh. Well, give us some examples. So imagine, you know, a listener now who is at that place that, you know, they're just really feeling like they don't have any other options. Mm-hmm. They've run out of options. They've tried everything. Nothing's working. And the idea of a permanent solution to what are, you know, they probably don't feel like temporary problems, but I think all problems are temporary. I think everything's temporary in this life. But so that, speak to that person about, you know, maybe give some examples about what that thing would be that you could pull out that says, okay, I can make it through the next hour. I could make it through this day.
Yeah. I mean, the answers can really differ, but for example, so I work specifically with autistic people. And so for a lot of non-autistic people, a big reason to live is like for their family or for those social relationships, or, you know, I want to be there for my mom or for my kids or whatever it is. And that is, I think that's a purpose and that's a reason to live easily. And then at the same time, you know, for example, with autistic people, we get really interesting answers like, you know, they're all different. It can also be social relationships, but it could be, you know, there's a big new video game coming out that I really want to play. And that is telling me like, okay, this is something that really matters to you. And how do we build on that? Like, how do we create community around video games or whatever it is? But that could be an example of an answer that I would get. You know, people can talk about like, I want to graduate or I want to, they're really unique, but I think the whole point is like, whatever it is that you're getting in that moment is a very honest and authentic answer.
The thing that strikes me, okay, going back to my question about, you know, well, how do they get that? How do you get that clarity? Or you mentioned about people who are suicidal seeing things very clearly. Oftentimes,
yeah.
I don't know if that's always the case, but getting the answer that's the real answer, mm-hmm. about what they're really interested in. Mm-hmm. I think there's something there that I'd kind of like to tease out of you, because for somebody who it's not that they're necessarily, more often than not, obviously I'm not a mental health professional, so I'm not dealing with people who are suicidal all the time, but I do hear from people who it's just a matter of practicality, mm-hmm. that they don't have any place to live. They don't have any food. They don't have money for food. They don't have a job. They can't get a job because they're homeless and can't take a shower and don't have the right clothes to wear to even to go on the job interview. I mean, it's like it can feel, and I've been in those kinds of situations when I was younger. So it can feel like there is absolutely no hope to right. this situation. I have nobody to help me. I have no options at all. The only thing left for me to do is to take my life. So in that kind of a situation where there's all these overwhelming issues, it seems to me that it's extremely valuable to be able to get the person to think clearly and pick one thing.
Exactly.
How do you, okay, take the person who, you know, their significant other just left them, so their heart is like bleeding, and they don't, you know, they shared the rent. So now this person doesn't have enough money to pay the rent. They're getting evicted. They literally are going to be with every single thing they own on the sidewalk. You know, they're like trying to figure out, I have no place to go. The homeless shelter is full. They won't take me, whatever. So they're just completely at the end of their rope. How in the world? What can you say to help them to find that one thing that can get them through?
Well, the caveat is those things are very real, and those things will always be there outside of the room that me and a patient are in. And I don't want to discount that. And at the same time, there's always hope. There's always one thing we can do to make that situation slightly better. One small thing. Whatever that looks like, where we really dig into like who do we have in your social context? Who haven't you not spoken to in years? Or what resource have we not thought of yet, right? So like we can really dig into that. But what I think happens in these moments is all of those things where you feel like you were left, or you don't have anywhere to go, or you don't have anywhere to live, all of that is saying, the way someone can hear it is, you don't matter. You're not worth being around, because we're going to make it so hard for you to be around that you hear it as, I don't matter. I shouldn't be here. My presence or my existence is so difficult that it just would be easier if I wasn't here. I'm not meant to be here. So in those moments, what I like to do as a therapist is like, let me be your proxy for hope for like this next hour. Let me tell you, you do matter, because we can find one thing that will get you a little step out of this situation. And let me just remind you, because I know you can't see it right now. You aren't hearing it from the world around you. You're having all these things tell you that you don't matter. You don't have anywhere to go. You don't have a place. And so what I want with my patients is for them to borrow my hope for like an hour until we take one step into living, right? Like, let's live for the next hour. You're doing the thing. And I know that we can, that you will move past this, that we can find steps to do it. But when you're in those situations where everything feels overwhelming, you're hearing it as, the world doesn't even want me here, kind of thing. And I want to counter that message for you right now, like, is what I like to do.
Wow. Okay. I have to say, okay, I'm just going to give full disclosure now to everybody who's listening. So you are the daughter of my best friend who said those things to me. It's amazing to me that what you just said, your mother said to me decades ago. And the beauty is, I know you went to school, you went a lot of years, I'm sure it was a lot of money, and now you have that, you know, you have those initials after your name. I want you to know that your mother was so brilliant that she said that stuff when she was 15. without any initials after her name at all. And so I think you probably had that natural gene before you even went to school. And I love that. I just love that you, what you just said, I love what you do, because to me, the beauty of what you just shared is that anybody listening right now can say those things to someone in their life who they think might be considering taking their life. We all can say, borrow my hope for an hour and let me be your proxy for hope. You matter. You're not seeing it right now, so hear it from me. I can say that. Without that education, without, I've always thought, oh, I don't have the, I'm not trained. I don't have the right words. I don't know what to say. God forbid I say the wrong thing. And I think a lot of us, a lot of lay people feel that way. That if we, that somehow, you know, if somebody's struggling and they're thinking about suicide, that we're scared that if we say the wrong thing, we're going to push them toward it. And it sounds to me like you've just equipped us to know. And then, okay, so suppose that we're in a situation with somebody we care about. This is, you know, we've had that conversation. Then what's next? What do you suggest a person does who's with somebody who's feeling that way? Mm-hmm. I mean, do you call the suicide hotline?
I think one of the misconceptions, like you mentioned earlier, is that us mentioning the word suicide or killing yourself, those words are going to put an idea in someone's head. We know that's not the case. And that if someone's considering it, they already have the words. And you saying the words are not going to push them any further than where they're already at. And so it's actually a lot better to be really clear in your communication and, you know, and use words like, are you going to hurt yourself? Have you thought about suicide or killing? Really being clear, because those words are not going to push someone over the line. We know that. And in fact, what unfortunately people can think is that when they're feeling that way, that they're crazy, that no one will understand. And what you're saying when you're asking them is, you're not crazy. I hear you. You're in a lot of pain and you're scared and you don't see a way out. Is this where you're at? Are you unsafe right now? And it sort of helps them feel like, okay, I'm not crazy. Like they get it. They understand how much pain I'm in. And then, of course, there's definitely resources. And then you sort of walk through the options with them. You know, if they're in therapy, they might have something already set up, like a safety plan. And then there's 988, which is a number that connects you directly to basically crisis supports instead of 911. So it's specifically for a mental health emergency. And then even better than that is to sort of find local resources if you can. Are there local crisis centers you could go to? And it really depends like how the person is presenting. But the big thing is not being freaked out by what they're saying, because that's going to freak them out. Taking it very seriously at the same time, saying, I hear you, and this is real. And then sort of walking with them through steps, different steps.
So stay calm, I hear you say, as calm as you can stay. You know, one of the things that I remember specifically your mother saying to me when we were 15 was, and you talked about it, I think, earlier, or at some point in our lives, you've said this to me. I don't know if it was in this podcast or not, but your mom used to say, okay, I get it. You're overwhelmed. There are 450 things that you've just named that are wrong. Let's take one. Mm-hmm. I mean, at 15 years old, and we're sitting in the little coffee shop across from Upland High School, and your mother said, okay, bring out a piece of paper, and start just write down each thing. Now put a number next to it. I'm thinking, how did she know to do this? And we're 15 years old. She said, put a number next to it. Like, what's the most important one? That make that number one. What's the second most important thing? Make that number two. And then she said, okay, so we're just going to do one right now. Mm-hmm. And I have to say, it really worked. It worked on me. I don't know if it would work with everybody, but I really believe in my heart of hearts that God gave your mother exactly the right words for me. That's what I needed, because it helped me. I felt like I was taking control. The overwhelm and anxiety no longer ruled me, because now I was actually doing something. Even taking out the paper and the pen, I was doing something. And then the fact that I was being heard and she was taking me seriously, and she didn't just completely dismiss it like, oh, come on, it's no. No, she just really, you know, she heard me. She really listened. And then with each thing, I would say, you know, whatever it was, well, I don't have any food. I haven't eaten in a couple days. And then, you know, and we would say, she would say, okay, well, where do you think you might be able to eat tonight?
Yeah, exactly.
And I hadn't really thought about this up until right now in this conversation, but I think what I've done in the past that was probably not the right thing to do is in having these kinds of conversations with other people, I think I have to provide the meal. I have to provide the place to live. I need to provide this person a car because their car broke down. They can't afford to fix whatever it is. I would think, okay, well, I'm Jesus Jr. Let me just buy you a new car, or let me, you know, whatever was the problem. I felt like I needed to fix it. And my heart was in the right place, but I wasn't teaching anybody how to work through their own stuff and figure out how, because, you know, when you're overwhelmed, your chances are in this life, you're going to get overwhelmed again. And if somebody just comes along and like fixes every single thing, then you haven't learned how to really be resourceful and do it.
Yeah. And I think it's the same approach we sort of take. We call it like reasons for living. And it's sort of it's like the opposite, where you have the problems and you list out like, what do I need to deal with first? Okay, I don't have food. That's going to be number one. We're going to deal with that first. And then reasons for living is like, you're taking the same approach and applying it to your life. Like, what is number one in your life? And I can't tell you that. Like, not your friend can't tell you that. Your family member can't tell you that. You really have to do some reflection to figure out what's, you know, one, and it might be 1A, 1B, 1C, whatever. That's fine. It doesn't need to be this perfect list. But it really is sort of taking a little bit more of a systematic, organized approach to like, yeah, why do you want to be here? Because there's a lot. Life is a lot, but why do you want to be here tomorrow?
Oh, that's really good. Why do you want to be here? I'm writing it down. I have to say, let me preface what I'm about to say. I'm going to talk about Brené Brown. Mm-hmm. Are you familiar with Brené Brown?
Yes.
Yeah. So everybody in mental health and most other humans on earth are familiar with Brené Brown. And there, a friend of mine who's a psychologist years ago talked to me about Brené Brown and her talks about empathy. And my friend sent me this little video. It's really cute. There are a gajillion views of this video, and it's a little cartoon. And there's a little, I don't know what this little animal is, this little woodland creature is in the hole. So I don't know if you know the one I'm talking about. So this creature's in the hole and depressed and, you know, sitting. And then here comes this little bear, and the bear's walking up, and the bear looks in the hole and sees this person. And the person's obviously depressed and they're suffering and they're having a hard, hard time. And the bear goes, "Hey, you hungry? You want a sandwich?" And so the thing, the whole point of the video is to say, get in the hole.
Yeah, exactly.
Show empathy. Okay, I have to say, here's my friend who's a psychologist, and she sends me this video and says, "Rhonda," she prefaces it with, "love ya, but you have to work on your empathy, because you're the bear who's offering a sandwich." And I'm like, well, hell yeah, I am, because I've been in the hole. I figured out how to get out. I'm never going back in that hole again. I can't help you. I can't lift you out if I get in the daggone hole. And I don't ever want to feel like that again. So let me, in the meantime, I've been homeless and I've been hungry. And I imagine if you're sitting there, you're hungry and I'm going to give you a sandwich. Here's my friend going, you're missing the whole point. Yeah. And I'm like, no, I'm sorry. I think you are. And I love her and it's great and we're good. But I've never forgotten. I think about, okay, here's Brené Brown, put together the video, probably spent money creating the little cartoon. It's very cute and everything. And everybody thinks that she is so fabulous because she came up with this whole thing about how we have to show empathy. And I'm thinking, she's never been homeless. She has never been hungry, because don't diminish the importance of the sandwich.
No, the sandwich is important. The sandwich is so important.
Thank you for agreeing with me.
The sandwich is important. And we can, yeah. And, you know, you could maybe do both, right? Like, you can have a little, it's not this black and white situation. Like, maybe you could, like, bring the sandwich down to the person and get in the hole with them.
Maybe I could reach and ask the person to come up halfway.
Yeah, you don't have to go live in the hole with them.
I can't do that.
The sandwich is real and the sandwich is important. And, you know,
I think obviously the point is, you know, let's have empathy for people. Yeah. That's very important. I just think that when you're the one who's hungry.
Yes.
And you haven't eaten. I mean, the longest I ever went without eating was 5 days. When you've gone 5 days without any food, I don't care if somebody comes up to me and shows Christ-like empathy. I'm hungry.
Right. Sure. And sometimes the problem is when someone is in a hole mentally, you may hand them a sandwich, right? And they may say, well, it doesn't matter because the day after tomorrow, I'm not going to have a sandwich. And it's like, okay, sure. And that doesn't mean that you shouldn't eat this sandwich. But let's just start with one sandwich, right? And then maybe let's figure out tomorrow. But like, I think that's the hopelessness can get in the way of seeing help when it's there too.
Ooh, that's a good point.
Right? Like there are a bunch of Rhondas maybe out there who are handing you a sandwich, but you aren't seeing it because you're like, well, Rhonda's going to give me one sandwich and then she's going to leave. It's like, well, that doesn't diminish the fact that she's giving you a sandwich. The sandwich is worth eating still.
Right. Oh my gosh. I mean, you touch on such an important thing that for people who really, you know, are suicidal, or maybe they're, you know, maybe they're just overwhelmed with what they're missing in their lives. And another thing that I experienced, and I experienced with your mom holding my hand through the whole thing as we were teenagers, but I would be so incredibly depressed and hurt and angry and all, you know, ball of emotions over what I didn't have.
Right.
It unrealistic expectations. I would get like a month before my birthday every single year, I would think, oh, maybe this is the year my mom's going to call me. Maybe this is the year she's going to show up. Maybe this is the year I'm going to get a birthday card. And I would get myself all worked up. And then the birthday would come, nothing at all. And then I'm depressed for a month because she didn't, because I had myself so worked up. Your mom used to say things like, you know, somebody could buy you a brand new Mustang and just hand it to you. And you wouldn't be happy about, like, that wouldn't do it for you because you didn't get a call or you didn't get a birthday card from me. I'm like, yeah, that's right. Like, what don't you get? But the point I'm seeing, you know, now, and I did, you know, I figured it out later, was, oh yeah, wait a minute. I'm not grateful that I have this amazing friend who's walking me through life. I'm not even seeing that. I'm not even seeing the good things that were happening because I was fixated on the one thing I didn't have, and it stole a lot of happiness from me.
Yeah.
So I want to encourage everybody who's listening gosh, think about what you do have. Focus on what you do have and you know, not so much on what you don't have. Find one thing at least that you can be grateful about.
And you think, I think you can have, because I don't love the toxic positivity narrative, like, because being frustrated and angry or disappointed, those are valid and important. So you can be mad. Go back to the sandwich example. You can continue to be mad and frustrated that you don't have a sandwich for Wednesday. And you can be happy that you have a sandwich on Tuesday. Because you being mad about not having a sandwich on Wednesday might push you to change to the sandwich system.
You know, what you just said makes me think about, so many of us get locked into the prison of two competing ideas.
Yeah.
Instead of considering that there could be five different things that can be true.
Exactly.
Once.
Yes. Yeah.
And sometimes just recognizing that, yeah, I can have this good thing that's happening in my life right now, but I could still be concerned about tomorrow. And I still don't have a place to sleep tonight or whatever it is. All of this can be true at once. And what I wish I knew then that I do know now, it's my choice mm-hmm. that in the midst of hard, hard things mm-hmm. that I can still choose. I can choose to have a good attitude.
Yeah.
And I suppose that goes to that, you know, the positive psychology thing, mm-hmm. but whatever anybody wants to call it, I just know it works for me. I only know what works for me, and it might not work for you. It might not work, but it works for me that I can say, okay, I mean, I've been through a lot of, it's not like I have a cake and ice cream life. I think people think, oh, she went from foster care to millionaire, so she's got this fabulous life. Well, guess what? I mean, you still can get diagnosed with atrial fibrillation. You still can need heart surgery. You still can get COVID. All the money in the world doesn't make it so that you never get cold in the winter and too hot in the summer. And, you know, it makes you more comfortable. Yeah, I can turn the air or the heat on. But it doesn't take away every problem. So when you're dealing with hard things, you literally can say, no, I'm not going to let this steal my joy. I'm going to find something to laugh about today. And I have my certain, you know, go-to stuff, you know, old Seinfeld episode. I can put on a ridiculous movie like Dumb and Dumber. I mean, there's just The Office or whatever. There's things, YouTube video of Sebastian Maniscalco. That's what I could do. So I can put on something that I know is just going to crack me up. It, whatever was going on that was not great, doesn't go away.
Yeah.
Right. It doesn't change the circumstances, but it helps me change the channel on my attitude and my mood. And that is valuable because when I'm, and it's today, as we're recording this, I think it's National Laugh Out Loud Day or something. I saw something on the internet today. I thought, okay, well, I do that every day. Everybody should laugh at least once a day. Find something to laugh about, because when you laugh, it's like you're telling your heart and your mind, there's something in this world still to laugh about.
Yeah, exactly. If you told me, it's a reason to live. If you told me I still laugh at a Seinfeld episode, I'd be like, that is a reason to live. We're going to start there. Put it on your list. And you know what? If that's it, if that's all we have, that's fine. We can start there.
I love it. I love it. Well, this has been so helpful. And I hope that somebody who thinks that they're out of options, or they just feel like they don't have anything to live for, or the world is giving them messages that say that, you know, they don't matter or whatever. I hope that if that's you and you're listening, I hope that this is helpful. And I hope that you'll share this with other people. And, you know, let's all take Dr. Morganne Reid's advice and let other people borrow our hope And I think that's how hope becomes contagious. So thank you for joining me today, Dr. Reid.